The world's most valuable collection of old racing cars was assembled at Brands for the Prince, a conservative estimate of their collective value, around £100 million. Through sponsorships and donations, the unique event raised around £100,000 for the Prince's Trust. At the head of this impressive lineup was the victorious Le Mans Jaguar team. London-based Johnny Dumfries was one of the successful drivers, and Prince Charles was clearly impressed.
The significance of it didn't really start dawning on me until we were actually into the race. And when we went there, I just thought, well, it's another race and I want to win it. I mean, I want to win every race I enter, so.
With a determined drop of the flag, today's cars were underway. Brands briefly resembled the M1, but with Le Mans winning Bentleys, Jaguars of the 50s, Bugattis and Ferraris amongst others, there can rarely have been such an historic traffic flow. The Bentleys caught the Prince's eye, a quick circuit as a passenger, with crash helmet on of course, before being allowed a go behind the wheel for himself. This 4.5-litre 1928 WO Bentley has fewer than 40,000 miles on the clock. Nobody seemed to mind that Charles put on an additional two or three by unexpectedly going for an extra lap.
He chose to drive the car. He wasn't encouraged to do it. It was his choice. As a matter of fact, he's driven all three cars that were here. It was just a wonderful sight, all these things. And to feel that I was at least partially responsible for it was one of the thrills of my life.
It was quite nostalgic to see three times world motor racing champion Jack Brabham back at Brands Hatch today. But it wasn't a sentimental journey. 62-year-old Sir Jack, as he now is, was working, helping his 23-year-old son Gary to become a Formula One driver. Gary was born in Wimbledon, brought up on an Australian sheep farm, but now drawn to motor racing, where he's beginning to shine. Is it his father's influence? Sir Jack says no.
Yeah, you're going to teach him some things. You can't teach him all the way. I can't hold a wheel for him, for instance. So most of it's down to him. I can give him advice, but when it's out in the circuit, it's all completely down to Gary.
Gary was in practice for Sunday's Euro Series 2000, the European Championship which helped spring on tomorrow's world champion. He's certain his progress has everything to do with his father.
My father's been so helpful with my racing career so far. I'm probably a year ahead of myself. That's why I've sort of come up so quickly from 19 months.
He won the British Grand Prix here back in 1966. Has he given you any tips on how to race this one?
Yes, give me a tip through paddock, and he told me to just go through there fast as I can until I spin, so I know the limit of the car, and it's since then I'm around the lap record.
As the wraps were lifted off the new car, the realization that the TG185 might never race began to set in. Designed at a cost of around £500,000 to space shuttle refinements, Toleman say it's well capable of Grand Prix success, with new number one driver Stefan Johansson behind the wheel. But Michelin's decision to opt out of racing has left them stunned. Goodyear and Pirelli have already allocated their contracts. Time for Toleman is now running out.
No, it's a serious problem for us, particularly as now we should be testing and we have no commitment from a tyre company. It's now in the lap of the gods as to whether or not we go racing in Formula One or not. Really, we have one option, which is Goodyear, and we just hope that they'll see in the car the potential we see and support us with tyres.
The building of the prototype is only a fraction of the $9 million it costs to race the Formula One circuit. Decisions on commercial sponsorship to help meet those running costs and the appointment of a second driver are both being delayed until the tyre contract is resolved. If the car fails to race, it would be a major blow, as everyone is convinced it's a winner.
I think it's a big improvement from the car we had last year, and the car we had last year was very good in the last few races, so I'm really excited about it.
Alan Jones, the 38-year-old Australian, said he was offered a package he couldn't refuse. He retired from the Grand Prix scene in 1981, a year after winning the world title. Amidst a show-busy launch, a Beatrice car was unveiled, but just to reveal the livery they'll be using. The car Jones will drive is still being developed. This is the design. It's a Lola powered by a Hart engine, and it should make its first appearance at the Italian Grand Prix in September. Jones, who will also move to the area, is looking forward to the challenge.
Well, I think it's the fact that I hadn't got the bug totally out of my system. The fact that this is a very unusual package in as far as it's a brand new team starting from scratch. I'll be able to come back and do 2 or 3 months of testing before I actually race the car. That'll give me an opportunity to develop with the team, get my eye in, and wait until we're totally competitive before we roll it out on the start line.
Money isn't a problem for the American backers. They've secured a contract for tyres, but won't say who with yet. The team have clearly been given a blank cheque.
Yes, that's partially true, but you really still need to spend the money wisely. There have been plenty of people who've had a lot of money and not done very well. Those choices be wise.
Surprisingly, Stirling Moss never became world motor racing champion, but in the late 50s and early 60s, he was British champion 10 times, and his performances around the world, when British drivers were the underdogs, turned him into a legend. It all came to a near tragic end on Easter Monday 1962. He crashed at Goodwood. He was left in a coma for a month and paralysed for 6 months. Now at 57, he's back in competitive racing for the first time. His famous lucky number 7, though, is left on the day car. But the familiar yellow crash helmet is still with him, creating a picture which all but turns back the years. He bought the Elva Mark 7 BMW for £30,000, and he's entered it in the historic sports car championships. Race 1 is at Brands next month. The 200 brake horsepower 2-litre engine is capable of reaching 150 miles an hour. So forget nostalgia, Stirling Moss is back for real.
I miss the thrill, I miss the action and the excitement and the atmosphere, you know. I mean, I go to Formula One races and enjoy them, but it isn't quite the same thing if you're not actually getting in the car and driving it.
It nearly took your life, of course. That doesn't concern you when you get back behind the wheel?
No, I mean, obviously one doesn't. I mean, it concerns me, but not because of the cars. I mean, I'm concerned it nearly took my life because it was a bit of an annoying thing. I had to work for a living instead of playing with motor cars.
It's remarkable that 25 years after his retirement, his name is still synonymous with the sport. For that, he says, he must thank his father.
My mother wanted to call me Hamish, and my father, thank goodness, said, no, forget it, think of another name. And my mother was Scots and from Stirling area. And so she said, well, let's call him Stirling. And my father said, yes, and I think that's been a tremendous help.